we'll get there in a minute. This is our third installment on the message that we started a couple of weeks ago called Favor Factor. And that understanding that everything in life, every event, every set of circumstances, or every event has an outcome, and that outcome will be determined by a certain set of factors. Factors will be involved in every circumstance, every situation, every outcome. There's factors involved in how sporting events complete. Factors involved in the weather. Factors involved in whether a business is successful. Would you turn me down just a tad bit, please? Pull me down a little bit. There are factors involved, and so we have to understand that there are a lot of natural factors involved in things in our life, but we have to understand and grasp the fact that there is one spiritual factor that can transcend and supersede all of the natural factors and cause things to turn around and change for our good in the fact that God's favor is for us. Amen. God is favoring His children, His men, His women, and we realize that some people think that what happens is all a matter of luck. That it's a matter of just being at the right place at the right time. And there is something to that, but it's not just coincidence. You see, luck, the definition of luck, and let me read it. It's that which happens to one seemingly by chance. I want you to know you're not here by chance. You're not on planet Earth. You don't live where you live by chance. You don't work in the place that you work by chance. You don't have things that come that are available, that operate, that function in your life by chance. It is a divine ordinance. It's a divine intervention. It's a divine connection somewhere. And so we realize that favor is God's influence released towards you, working for you to put you over in the arena of life. It's God working on your behalf very often behind the scenes, so you may not see it, you may not feel it, but suddenly something works out and you say, wow, that was great. But we have to understand that very often that God is working, He's always looking for a way for His favor to operate in your life. I made a statement 2 weeks ago, and I believe it bears repeating, that you cannot look at your past as a predictor or a precedent of your future. You can't look at where you've been, what you have or have not accomplished, what kind of life you lived or haven't lived, to determine where you're going to be 5 years from now, where you're going to be 10 years from now, or where you're going to be tomorrow. You can't look at your past failures and even your past successes to determine and to predict where you're going to be. Because at any given time, you got to realize that God's favor can operate in your life, and suddenly the failures that you've experienced, the depression that you've had, the poverty that you've lived in, the sickness you lived in, can suddenly be turned around and altered so that you're now living a different life, living in prosperity, living in health, living in peace, living in direction rather than confusion. You can have that because it's God's favor operating and wanting to operate in you. I gave you a definition for favor. It was your advantage to succeed in life. Your advantage to succeed in life. That's God's favor in you, working for you, His influence going there to you. We looked at, you know, and it's one thing to teach principles by precept. And we learn by precept, but you know, it's a lot easier sometimes to learn by example. to learn by someone's example, how did they do this, and maybe this I can get the same results. Now, you got to realize that what that does for us is that it does something to hope. It does something on the inside of us. It puts something that because this happened to that individual, there can be a potential for that happening in my life. So it gives me some hope. But listen, that hope can only be activated if I get to the same place in my life that that person was in their life. Trusting and believing and releasing that faith. Do you understand that? And so we listen, we read, and we hear testimonies of how God did this and did that. And it excites us because that gives me an opportunity or possibility that this can happen to me. But unless I get my life in order in the same way that person's life was in order and release my faith, then that thing may not happen unless I get to that place. So we looked at a couple of people in the Old Testament. The first one we looked at was Daniel. And we found out, listen, I don't ever hope. I don't ever even dream of being in a lion's den. Not literally. But listen, some of us have been in a lion's den figuratively, where there were people around us, there were events around us that would have destroyed us had we allowed it to. And God delivered us out of that. Amen. And you all know what I'm talking about. Some of you can, you know, you got an event, something right there in your mind. You just see, yes, that's where I was. Well, see, that was God's favor delivering you out of that. But the one thing that Daniel did that I believe if we ever find ourselves in that place, the one thing that Daniel did that we're going to have to do consciously for ourselves is that we cannot allow the culture of the world to influence and affect our life. We've got to choose and make a decision not to defile ourselves with the culture that's out there, which means that I can't live according to the culture that's out in the world. I've got to live according to the culture that I learned from the Word of God. Amen. So that means that if I've got to make some adjustments on the inside, make some adjustments in my mind, make some adjustments in my heart, and that when I'm drawn and I'm pulled in that direction, I've got to say no, I won't go that way. Just like Daniel did when you know he had that 10 days where he made this decision to fast. That they were just going to eat what they were accustomed to eating in their nation of Israel. But now he was in a new environment. He was now a slave, and he was in a new environment. And you know, he wanted to prosper. He wanted to succeed. But he made this choice. Listen, give me what I've accustomed to eating. And if for 10 days I'm not any better than the guys that you are eating the rest of the stuff that's in this other culture, then I will yield to you. But you know the story. The word says he and his counterparts were 10 times better than those who had eaten of the culture of the world or the king's table. I'm telling you, that is a choice that we have to make, and I believe we have to make that choice every day. We looked at a man by the name of Joseph, and we saw some keys to the why he was successful. Now, Joseph was a young man at 17, and I'm not going to go into all of it because I got three more people I want to look at this morning. First of all, Joseph said, and he made this decision, listen, we cannot forsake God no matter what happens. We might be having some tragedies taking place. We may have some loss. We may have some disappointments. We may have some things, and we throw our hands up in the air and say, God, why? Why me? But we got to realize I cannot forsake God and turn my back on God no matter what happens, no matter what the circumstance might be. I've got to stay on God's side. And that's imperative. Number two, with Joseph, we've got to always, now listen, this is not always easy, but sometimes we got to be talked into it. We got to always forgive. no matter what. Now, Pastor, you just don't know what they did to me. I don't know. The latter part of that sentence just doesn't, it's hard to come out, but I don't care. Because it's imperative that we listen to the word. And or you might say it this way, I don't know, and it's important to you to forgive so that you don't have that anchor in your soul and in your heart so that you can't get to where God wants you to be. It's like that one person says, you know, if you got a problem, you just go get a ladder and get over it. Number three, you got to hold on to your dreams no matter what. Joseph had a dream, and that dream was important, and he held on to that dream, and that dream took him from where he was. It took him, and he got to a place of being a slave, and then he wound up in jail, in prison, but that dream stayed alive in his heart. But I can think that his mind kept the same. But God, you gave me a dream. When is it ever going to happen? It took 13 years before his dream came to pass. Number four, when Joseph, always be diligent no matter what. Always be diligent to do your best wherever you are. You see, a lot of times we think, well, you know, I'm just passing through this two-bit job. I'm just passing through this two-bit operation. I'm just passing through this little bitty. My dad used to use some colorful language, but we won't use that this morning. We're just passing through here. And consequently, if you're just passing through, you're not going to put out your full effort. Joseph was diligent to do his best in every place that he found himself. And then the last one, and it's always difficult. Never complain, no matter what. No matter how long pastor preaches, never complain. See, favor elevated Joseph from a slave and a prisoner to the prime minister's position in Egypt. You see, we've got, in order for us to have that favor, to believe for that favor, we've got to have faith that it'll operate in me. It'll operate for me. I've got to have faith in that respect. So Psalm 89, verse 17, you should have your Bibles there. It says, you are the glory of their strength, and in your favor our horn is exalted. Now, what does that mean? I don't have any horns. You know, Mom used to say every time one of the kids was crying, oh, we got a horn broken, you know. But it wasn't so much the horn. So really, we have to understand, looking at that verse of Scripture, we see this. He says, for you are the glory of their strength, and in your favor our horn is exalted. What is David saying? David is using some figurative language here. He's using some language that I think we can, when we begin to understand, he says, your glory. When we think of the glory of God, we always think of his presence, of his heaviness, of his the all the things that are good. And this word is partly that, but this word means ornament, the brilliance. And as you study it, it comes from a root word that means to explain. Think about it. For you are the explanation of their strength. So when you have strength, God is the reason for your strength. His presence in your life is the explanation of why you can overcome. The explanation of why those challenges and those difficulties never seem to destroy you as it has destroyed others. Why? Because it's His glory, His strength in you that causes you. What does Paul say? I can do what? All things through Christ who does what? Who strengthens me. You got to realize that he wasn't talking about just, you know, going to work every day. He wasn't talking about some outward thing. When you read the context, Paul said that I know what it's like to be abased. I know what it's like to be abound. I know what it's like to be hungry. I know what it's like to have difficulty and be in difficult situations, but I'm telling you this, I can do all things. So you got to realize the context in which he was saying that is that his glory, his presence, his strength is what makes you strong. Amen. Then he says, and in your favor and in your influence. Now, when you use the word horn, he's not literally meaning a horn. We're thinking something that's protruding out of our head, but what he's talking about is the power, the strength, the force, the ability, the capacity, all that you are. He says this. So he says, so you are the explanation of their strength, and in your favor, their ability is exalted. Their capacity is exalted. Listen, when God's favor is on you, you can do more than you would without his favor. When God's favor is on you, you will understand better than when it's not on you. When God's favor is on you, you can be a better teacher. You can be a better employee. You can be a better electrician. You can be a better mechanic. You can be a better manager. You can be a better anything. When his favor is on you, you can be a better store owner than when his favor is not on you. So when you understand that, you say, okay, Lord, I want your favor. You start believing for his favor. You start asking him for his favor and recognize that his favor is right available to each and every one of us. I believe when we look at the life of King David, there were some things about King David that were just enormous. And we know that King David had some favor. And we find that in one instance, I'm jumping a little bit. Let me get up here. In one instance, in 1 Samuel chapter 16, Samuel the prophet was told to go and anoint another king because the Spirit of God had left Saul. And so Samuel goes to Jesse's house, and he's going to anoint one of Jesse's sons as the king. Well, they parade all of Jesse's older sons in front of him, but they leave David out because he's the youngest one. He's out in the pasture. And so the Spirit of God said, none of these are the one. So Samuel asked Jesse, do you have another son? Thinking, I must have missed God. And Jesse said, yes, we have one, but he's out in the pasture tending the sheep. He said, go get him. And he came and he got him and brought him in. And the Spirit of God spoke to him. He said, anoint him. And in verse 12, he says, and Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon him from that day forward. Listen, when God anoints you, the favor of God will be on you. Because it was on David, and it'll be on us. And so we realize that we have the Spirit of God living on the inside of us, and that favor is always available and always there. I just need to be sure that I'm doing the things that are necessary to activate it and allow it to happen. And we find a little bit later in that King Saul, after the Spirit left him, King Saul was troubled in his mind. I don't know what he was having, if he was just having depression, which it sounds like what he was doing. He was probably bipolar long before they ever came up with the bipolar definition. And he was having some depressed moments, and someone made the statement, let's just get somebody that can play an instrument. come and play, and maybe that spirit will leave you. And someone said, yeah, I know somebody. He's out there in the pasture. I hear him singing. And he's singing to the sheep. He's singing by himself. But he's singing to God. And so they bring David in. And the word says that he found favor in the sight of the king. Because he would play and the spirit would leave him. And it says that the king loved David. And he asked his father Jesse, can you let him come and live in my house so that I can, so he can play his instrument? And so then David comes in and becomes part of the king's household. This is before Goliath ever showed up. It was God's favor upon David. And then David, I like this. Let me back up. I'm switching this thing around a little bit. David was a man of praise. We often read Psalm 23. I had the opportunity to conduct a memorial service just this week. And one of my closing is Psalm 23. But you look at Psalm 23, and it is a praise to God. It is acknowledging that God can help him with anything. So the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Most of you can quote it. I shall not want. Now, you know, the sentence ends right there. But what is it in your life that you don't have enough of right now? Maybe it's health. Maybe it's money. Maybe it's a better job. Maybe it's a job, period. Add that to that end of that sentence. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want for money. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want for peace. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want for sleep. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want for good health. Add that. See, what is that? David is proclaiming that God is his everything and that in God there is no lack. In God there is no want. Then he goes on, he makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. I had a friend of mine back in at Rhema, and he and I painted houses together. And he's my age, and he had been, you know, at the time we were there, we were in our 30s, and he used to do crack cocaine. He said he started at the age of 15. He said by the age of 20, he couldn't add 2 + 2. He said his mind was so gone, his soul was so messed up, his mind was all he could do. He knew how to paint, and that's all he could do was paint. But then he got born again at the age of 25, and God started changing some things. He got off of that stuff, and he got a hold of this verse. He said, he restores my soul. He restores my soul. He restores my soul. Giving God all the glory. And so we got to Bible school together, and this guy was sharp as a tack. I mean, his mind had been restored. He was able to think, and I mean, he could, and he's now pastoring a church up in Portland, Oregon, has been for about the last 15 or 16 years. What am I saying? That it doesn't matter what your past has been, God can restore it. It's his favor, it's his healing, but you got to understand it, you got to receive it, you got to begin to claim it. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Listen, if you don't know it, you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death on planet Earth. You look all around you as there's death everywhere. There's wickedness everywhere. It's incipient. There's sickness everywhere. There's poverty everywhere. There's violence everywhere. If you don't know it, you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death. And you better recognize that you're walking through it right now. And you've got to know that you can fear no evil, and that his rod and his staff will protect you as you walk through that valley of the shadow of death. But glory to God, we're not going to stay in this valley all of our life. Praise the Lord. We're going to walk through it. And then one glorious day, praise the Lord, we're going to go to sleep and wake up in heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Either that or Jesus will come back and take us with him. What will happen? Some of us may live long enough to see Jesus return. But if not, you'll meet him one time. Amen. And so we need to be ready. Glory to God. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Glory to God. They got barbecue on that table. They got some, listen, you ain't lived till you had some of my gumbo. It got some of that gumbo. And listen, it's not just mine, but you in the presence of your enemies. That doesn't mean when we get to heaven, because you're not going to have any enemies in heaven. You're going to he said he's prepared that table for you so that you can have all that you need, all that you require right here in the valley of the shadow of death. I don't know about you, but that's favor if there ever was anything. Amen. So there's three things that David did. We need to get on. I just get carried away. As they say, the acorn don't fall far from the tree. praise the Lord. David was a man of praise. Number two, David was a man of repentance. Listen, David made some serious judgment errors. David committed horrible sin. And yet, in Acts chapter 13, God says, David is a man after my own heart. That just doesn't blow my mind, because I don't want my mind blown. But that just, I had to ask God, how could that be? Reading 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, and the challenges and the things that David did, and 1 Kings and all the things that he did, and yet God said, that's a man after my heart. Because you see, David wasn't afraid to repent when he made a mistake. God, he wasn't afraid to run to God rather than run away from God. There's two types of believers. There's the believer that sins and runs away from God, and there's the believer who sins but runs to God and says, God, I need your mercy. God, I need your touch. And so David ran to God. And he was also, number three, David was a man who relied upon the mercy of God. Listen, that's where we need to be, is relying upon the mercy of God. There's two other people I want to look at just real quick, because we can see favor operating in their life. They were under the most dire circumstances and conditions in their life. When we pick up their story from the Old Testament, one was by the name of Ruth. Ruth's husband dies, her father-in-law dies, her brother-in-law dies, and we don't know why they died, they just died. And Naomi, the mother-in-law, says to her two daughters-in-law, listen, you're still young, you can get remarried, why don't you go back to your people, the Moabites, and you find another husband, you don't have any children, you find another husband. And she says, you know, the name Naomi was means to be bitter. She says, I'm going to go back to my country. I understand that there's a good harvest there. There's a lot of plenty there. And I've got somebody that'll take me in. And so you go back. And one of the daughter-in-law says, okay, gives her mother-in-law a hug and leaves. And Naomi says, no, No, no. I'm connected to you. Where you go, I'm going. And your God is going to be my God. I'm going to follow you. I'm going to turn my back on this, and I'm going to follow you. And then in the process of time, they get to Israel, and there's the barley harvest and the barley harvest. And one of the things that the wealthy landowners did in order to help people who were indigent, who helped the poorer people, is that when they harvested, they would always tell their harvesters, their gleaners, their harvesters, not to take all of the wheat. Not to take all of the barley, but to leave some out in the field so that they were called gleaners. They could come behind them and they would get something for them. They would be able to pick what was left over in the field. And so he told them, and he saw this young lady in the field along with a bunch of others. And he told his workers, he said, don't touch her, leave her alone, but be sure you leave extra for her. And then she says, why have I found favor in your sight? And he says this, it has come to my attention what you did for your mother-in-law. Listen, don't do bad stuff to your mother-in-law. Do some good stuff to your mother-in-law. I don't know where that came from. But anyway, do good things for your mother-in-law. But he says, I saw what you did for her. And then she says, oh, that I would find favor in your eyes. And that I would be different than the other maidservants in your house. And you know the rest of the story. She marries Boaz. And she becomes the great-grandmother of King David. And she's one of three Gentile ladies who are in the lineage of Jesus. Glory to God. And the thing that impressed me with this is that two things for her. One was loyalty. She was loyal to her mother-in-law. She was loyal where the Spirit of God connected her. Listen, it's imperative that you and I find something we can be loyal to. That the Spirit of God connects us to something. Listen, you know, this is difficult. But when the Spirit of God connects you to a church, you need to be loyal to that church. You need to be loyal to that pastor. You need to be loyal. Listen, I'm not presumptuous to think that God doesn't move people from here to there at seasons in their life. I believe that that is the case. But when he plants you in a place, then you stay in that place and grow fruit and produce something within that structure. Amen? Loyalty. Number two for Ruth was selflessness. She was selfless in herself. There was some sacrifice involved. But you know what? When it's God, it might look like sacrifice to everybody else, but to you it's not. It might look like you're sacrificing your life, your energies, your time, your youth, your everything, but to you, it's not sacrifice. Others will say, why do you do that? Why do you keep living that way? Why do you give 10%? Why do you sow above that? Why do you, man, that's sacrifice. You're sacrificing a lot. We look at it, no, I'm not sacrificing, it's a seed. I'm just living my heart. I'm just doing what God says for me to do. Does that make sense? So there's sacrifice, selflessness that doesn't look like it to us, although other people might read it as just that. Then there's a third person that we wanted to talk about just briefly this morning. And you know, the thing about it is that we read the Bible. we read these stories, and sometimes they're just stories, and they're distant stories. I try to read the Bible, and I try to put myself in their place, so that I can experience, I can try to grasp what they're going through. We said that with Joseph and King David, and you know, a lot of times we want to put ourselves at the end of the story, when the story has all come out good, and the end results are good. You know, we want to put ourselves at the end of Job, when he's got double. But sometimes we got to go back and put ourselves in the middle or at the beginning to understand how they could make this choice and do this and recognize because they did it this way, because they lived this way, because they made that choice, because Daniel made that choice not to defile himself, he went through the lion's den. And he lived to see four different kings and serve four different kings. And the other three, all four of them died long before Daniel did. So we look at the lady by the name of Esther, a little teenage girl. And when the nation of Israel and Judah was overrun, she was picked up, her parents were killed, and she's fortunate in that her first cousin takes her in by the name of Mordecai. Obviously, he must have been considerably older than her, and he takes her in and raises her as his own daughter. Now, he must have put some things into her, put some understanding into her, and put some trust into her, put some spiritual comprehension into her, because she trusted God. And so when she was picked for this beauty pageant to become the next queen, you've got to understand there's between 400 and 1,400 young ladies. It's going to take more than perfume and soft skin to have favor with the king. This is, you know, if you ever applied for a job and there's 15 applicants, and you say, God, I want favor. She's applying for a job. She's really not applying for the job. She really didn't want the job, but she was forced into applying for this job. There's 1,400 others, prettiest ones in the kingdom, and she's one of them. But there's something about her that she's got favor with the chamberlain. I believe it's her character. It's not necessarily her good looks. It's not necessarily anything about her other than the way she carries herself and that she projects herself, that there's some character about her. There's something about her. Maybe she was a little feisty more so than the others. Maybe she was just humble and obedient and listened to instructions and followed. Though she did not want to be there, though she was in a foreign land, though she was a foreigner, and she knew what the night with the king meant, she said, I'm going to do my best, and I'm going to humble myself and just do what I know to do. But when it came time for her night, the chamberlain said, what do you want to bring with you? What do you want to bring with your night that you're going to spend with the king? And he said, because you have your choice. You can take whatever you'd like to bring in to meet the king. Listen to her answer. She said, what do you think the king would like and appreciate? Because she said, it's not about me. It's about the King. It's not about myself and what I want. It's what does the King want? And so there was this humility about her that says, listen, it's not about me. It's about the King. I like this. Let's see. I had it written down. Humility always precedes favor. Knowing what the King wants. Watch. Knowing what the King desires makes you the King's favorite. And if you've got favor with the King of Kings, then you'll have favor with man. If you know, and so humility, recognizing, listen, I can't tell you how many times I've been in offices with powerful men that could shut the church down, that could change the direction of things, but you go in, when we were building this facility, when we were about to build this facility, listen, there was another small one in the city of Lafayette at one time, over on Dulles at Family Life, but nobody had built anything this big, and two of them side by side. I went to Metrocode and I said, I need your help. The magic words, if you're going to deal with Metrocode. You can't go in, this is what we're going to do. And they just buck up and say, nah, well, we'll see about that. No, you go in humbly. And listen, it's amazing. Now watch this. Humility knows when to be assertive. Humility knows when to be bold. And knows when to approach things diplomatically. Uses the proper protocol. You see, when Queen Esther went in to meet the King, she said, I'm just concerned about the King. But there came a point in time when all of her people were to be annihilated. And her cousin says, you know, could it be that you have come to power for such a time as this? And she took some bold steps with the King. She did it humbly. She did it properly. She did it with the proper protocol. And Haman was hung on his own gallows. And those who had planned against them were defeated and they were destroyed because of Queen Esther's humility and her proper place. Listen, you don't know what the future holds. But it's possible that God is putting you in the position of favor in your life, in your environment, in your business, in your neighborhood, in your city, in your state, so that you can be the hinge pin upon which their salvation depends. Not eternal salvation, but their support, their supply, their condition. You're the channel of what God has for them. Because you never know whether you have come to the kingdom of God for such a time as this. Because we look at our economy, we look at the world around us, and we need to know that there could be some real challenges. I'm not predicting anything, but there could be some opportunities in the future. There could be some real difficulties in the future. There could be some real financial difficulties in the future. But God, I believe, is positioning you both spiritually and physically so that His favor can be seen. See, the Word says that He's looking to and fro. I'm not sure what to and fro means other than He's looking left. and he's looking right, he's looking here, and he's looking there, and he's looking everywhere to find somebody. And the word says he finds somebody who he can show himself strong on their behalf. I like to think of it this way. He's looking for somebody who he can show his favor in their life. And when you know that you are favored of God, then things are going to work for you. But it's going to require us to be loyal. It's going to require us to be people of praise. It's going to require us not to be defiled by the world and the world system. It's going to be required of us to have a repentant heart, because we still live in this human body. It's going to be required of us to depend upon God and not upon ourselves. It's going to be required of us to be humble, because we recognize that humility will always precede his favor. Amen. Praise you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. During praise and worship, I just sensed that there was someone, maybe more than one, and I always have to pray whether I'm supposed to do this after praise and worship or during the after the message. And maybe there's more than one, but I know that perhaps just one. That your heart has just been broken. Just find yourself in just a very difficult place, and it's like almost at the place of just throwing up your hands and giving up and say, what's the use? Because I can't do this anymore. I don't know if that's who that is this morning, but I'd like to pray for you, because I believe that there's a word, and I don't have it right now, but I know that the way the Lord works with me, as soon as I sit in front of you, that word will come. Is there anybody like that here? That's just you. I could miss it. Yeah, I see that hand. Anybody else want to join that young lady? I want to pray for you, darling.